Now, this is an extremely risky and bold move from Peter. character. I imagine him hunched over, trying to shield his face from being seen in the light. And then there is this heart-stopping moment for Peter, where somebody recognises him, and the fingers start to point, and the accusations fall. You were with Jesus. You are one of his disciples. Peter is caught on the wrong side, and the pressure is mounting. Three times the fingers point, and in fear, three times Peter denies Jesus. He defends himself. He tries to distance himself as much as possible. He protests loudly, and then the rooster crows. And Peter is taken back to earlier that evening when he said to Jesus, "Lord, I'm ready to go with you to prison and to death." Yet Jesus knew that when the fingers would point at Peter, he couldn't stand. He said earlier, "I tell you, Peter, before the rooster crows today, you will deny three times that you know me." Now, it's very easy to read about Peter's denials and give him a hard time. But he was remarkably brave to follow Jesus to the courtyard. And in honesty, I'm not sure I would have gotten as far as the fire. Yet even Peter, which means the rock, found that his faith in Jesus, when it came to it, was actually rather rocky. Even Peter, under accusation, falls. So let's return to the narrative, verse 63 to 71. The men who were guarding Jesus began mocking and beating him. They blindfolded him and demanded, "Prophesy, who hit you?" And they said many other insulting things to him. At daybreak, the council of the elders of the people, both the chief priests and teachers of the law, met together, and Jesus was led before them. "If you are the Christ," they said, "tell us." Jesus answered, "If I tell you, you will not believe me, and if I ask you, you would not answer. But from now on, the Son of Man will be seated at the right hand of the mighty God." They all asked, "Are you then the Son of God?" He replied, "You are right in saying I am." Then they said, "Why do we need any more testimony? We have heard it from his own lips." So the long, cold, dark night has now passed, and as the sun rises, the leading authorities of the Jews begin to question Jesus. And Jesus' answers make them furious. In Matthew's Gospel, Jesus says the same thing. "You will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One." And when he says this, the high priest tears his clothes and shouts that Jesus has spoken blasphemy. The authorities agree that Jesus is worthy of death. Why? You know, what's so significant about the Son of Man? Now, very often in the Gospels, people refer to Jesus as the Christ or Messiah, which means the Anointed One. However, whenever Jesus is called this, he responds by calling himself the Son of Man. In fact, this is the most common title that Jesus uses for himself. And by using the title, the Son of Man, Jesus is referring back to some words in the Old Testament by the prophet Daniel. And the Jews would have absolutely picked up on the reference. Now, I did a little bit of research for this, and the Bible Project put it very well. They describe it like people in our culture being able to finish a quote from famous movies. So I'm going to try one, and you better get it, otherwise the analogy doesn't work. You ready? Yes, it worked! Great! So we're familiar with Star Wars, so we get the reference. And the same is true of the Son of Man passage in Daniel. So in Daniel 7, verse 13 to 14, it says, "In my vision at night I looked, and there before me was one like a Son of Man, coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All peoples, nations, and men of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that that will never be destroyed. So when Jesus is telling the chief priests and teachers of the law that he is the Son of Man, he is saying that he is the one that this passage refers to. He is the one and only Son of the Almighty God and will be given all authority, glory, and sovereign power. And there are also many other prophets in the Old Testament who prophesied how this Son of Man would die to save the world from their sins. And it makes them furious. So it's now Jesus' turn, rather than Peter's turn, to be accused. Let's return to the passage in verses 23-27. Then the whole assembly rose and led him off to Pilate. And they began to accuse him, saying, "We have found this man subverting our nation. He opposes payments of taxes to Caesar and claims to be Christ the King." So Pilate asked Jesus, "Are you the King of the Jews?" "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. Then Pilate announced to the chief priests and the crowd, "I find no basis for a charge against this man," but they insisted. "He stirs up the people all over Judea by his teachings. He started in Galilee and has come all the way here." On hearing this, Pilate asked if the man was a Galilean. When he learned that Jesus was under Herod's jurisdiction, he sent him to Herod, who was also in Jerusalem at the time. So they bring all kinds of false claims against Jesus. But the irony is they won't believe the one true claim that they bring, that Jesus is the King of the Jews. Pilate, the judge, can find no reason to punish Jesus, so he sends him to Herod. And this is the same Herod who beheaded Jesus' cousin, John the Baptist. Herod lives a very cruel life of self-indulgence, and he wants to use Jesus purely for his own entertainment. Either through seeing Jesus perform miracles or by mocking him. So let's see how that comes out. Verse 8. When Herod saw Jesus, he was greatly pleased, because for a long time he'd been wanting to see him. From what he had heard about him, he hoped to see him perform some miracle. He plied him with many questions, but Jesus gave him no answer. The chief priests and the teachers of the law were standing there, vehemently accusing him. Then Herod and his soldiers ridiculed and mocked him. Dressing him in an elegant robe, they sent him back to Pilate. That day, Herod and Pilate became friends. Before this, they had been enemies. So they continue to point the finger. They continue to accuse Jesus. And unlike Peter, Jesus doesn't defend himself. He doesn't deny who he is. He doesn't point the blame somewhere else. He doesn't protest. He restrains unleashing the mighty power of God to save himself, and instead allows the accusations to fall. And the result of these accusations is that Jesus is led back to the judge Pilate to pass sentence. So verse 13-25. Pilate called together the chief priests, the rulers, and the people, and said to them, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion. I've examined him in your presence, and I found no basis for your charges against him, neither has Herod, for he sent him back to us, as you can see. He has done nothing to deserve death. Therefore, I will punish him and then release him." With one voice, they cried out, "Away with this man, release Barabbas to us." Now, Barabbas had been thrown into prison for an insurrection in the city and for murder. Wanting to release Jesus, Pilate appealed to them again, but they kept shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." For the third time he spoke to them, "Why? What crime has this man committed? I have found in him no grounds for the death penalty. Therefore I will have him punished and then release him." But But with loud shouts, they insistently demanded that he be crucified, and their shouts prevailed. So Pilate decided to grant their demand. He released the man who had been thrown into prison for insurrection and murder, the one they asked for, and surrendered Jesus to their will. Now Jesus has been deserted by all of his disciples. He's been falsely accused by the highest authorities in Jewish culture. He's been rejected by the crowds 3 times, and he's been denied by his closest friend 3 times. And the passage ends with Pilate saying that surrendering Jesus to their will. However, Pilate was only able to surrender Jesus to the will of the crowd because Jesus was already surrendered to his Father's will. And it was God's will for Jesus to face these accusations, to be judged to die and to be punished by death on the cross. Why? Well, because over all of mankind there stands the ultimate accuser, the devil. And the other name for the devil, Satan, it literally means the accuser. And he also points the finger at each one of us in the presence of God, our righteous judge, and he says we are worthy of death. And the horrifying thing is, he is right. In Romans 3:23, it says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." And later in Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. Now, if we turn back to a slightly smaller section of the passage, in chapter 23:14-16, we actually see this eternal truth mirrored incredibly well in this bit of narrative of accusation being brought to the judge, being sentenced, and punishment. So Jesus is accused, and he is brought to the judge, Pilate. Pilate says, "You brought me this man as one who was inciting the people to rebellion." And whilst Jesus was examined in the presence of the judge and nothing is found wrong, we are examined in the presence of God and the mess and filth of our lives is exposed. Jesus had done nothing to deserve death, but we have. We've rebelled against God, and that rebellion is called sin, and the price of our sin is death. Jesus was willing to be accused of something that was true of us, but not true of him. He was willing to be accused of sinning against God, even though he hadn't, and we had. And here is the most incredible, outrageous truth of the gospel. In verse 16, the judge Pilate says, "Therefore, I will punish him and release him." And the righteous judge God says, when we are brought before him and accused by Satan and our sin exposed, with our eternal death sentence hanging in the air, "Therefore, I will punish Jesus and release you." And next week, we're going to hear about how this punishment leads to Jesus being crucified. It's our wrong that leads to Jesus' cross. And the glorious good news is this, that whoever believes in Jesus and accepts the price of death that he paid for our sins on the cross, we have our sin completely wiped out. So instead of being dragged before God by Satan to be judged in our filthy, sinful rags, we're washed by the blood of Jesus and we're given pure robes of righteousness to wear. And Satan, the great accuser, can't accuse us. There's nothing to accuse. He doesn't have a leg to stand on. When he points the finger, there's nothing for it to point at because we're washed clean by Jesus. The accusation of Satan is crossed out because of the cross. And this news gets even better because we're not just pardoned for our sin, we're adopted into the family of God. We get to share the most amazing inheritance with Jesus. We get to be embraced by God as his child. We get to be lavished on him with his love and adored by him. And we get to delight in that relationship now and for the rest of eternity. And if that's not good enough news, there's even more good news that one day the accuser Satan is going to be completely destroyed. The disciple John had a vision, and it's written down in the book of Revelation. And Revelation 12, verses 9 to 11 says this: "The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, 'Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony.'" But here remains a very serious truth nestled amongst all of this good news. For those who don't accept Jesus and the price of death he paid for our sin, we stay in the filthy rags of sin. And the accuser Satan, when he points the finger, will be right. God, the righteous judge, will punish that person for the sin. The ultimate death, being banished from his presence, hurled down with Satan for all eternity. And God doesn't want to lose a single person this way. He went to the most extreme length, sending his only son, Jesus, to be punished instead of us. But the very serious truth is that we decide where that finger rests. So the question is, if you haven't, will you say yes to Jesus? Or will you allow the accusing finger of Satan to stay pointed at you? Now, Jesus knew that Peter couldn't stand up under the accusations. And that's why he prophesied that the rooster would crow. And Jesus knows that we can't stand up under the accusation of Satan. And that's why he fulfilled all the prophecies that he would die. Now, even when we say yes to Jesus, Satan will continue to accuse us. He will sow lies and try to undermine the truth of what Jesus has done for us, that we are now holy and blameless in the sight of God. And there's a real tension as Christians because we still sin and we still mess up. But it's important to know that in the times when Satan would blame us and want to trap us in shame and helplessness, the Holy Spirit comes and he shows us what needs to change and leads us back to the cross, where we may receive the grace of God and the power of Jesus to transform us. So if you're in Christ this afternoon, we must daily remind ourselves that Satan cannot accuse us and be on our guard when he tries to. And this comes from daily returning to what Jesus has finished for us on the cross and bringing our sins to him. One of my favourite hymns ever puts it this way: "When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end to all my sin. Because the sinless Saviour died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. God the just is satisfied to punish Jesus."